Ken Wright is Simon's partner. He's a local apiarist.
Apiarist.
Yes. He's going to come up next. Moving right along. I'd like to welcome Mr. Ken.
Well, I suppose you want to know something about my qualifications before I start talking about all this sort of stuff, because it is important to understand what people actually have done in the past, correct? They must work from it. I was raised in a beekeeping family. My father was a commercial apiarist. So I was raised in the open, out in the bush all my life. My dad teaching me, he was probably one of the greatest. He taught me a numerous amount of knowledge, unbelievable amount of wisdom that came from him. But I didn't actually get to beekeeping until about, 1987. Yeah. I was a beekeeper, but I never had any of my own bees. It was always my father was a beekeeper, and I was just hanging on. But then in 1987, we decided we would buy some bees, and I began to learn a lot more about actually managing beehives. I have, as I was talking to Chris just now, a little bit of a negative aspect about the future of the beekeeping industry unless we take amazing innovation at this point in time. So I do believe that we are on a precipice. So this is what my talk today is, just to give you a little bit of an insight of what we as beekeepers face. Because we are under a lot of pressure. Beekeepers are under an enormous amount of pressure, both environmentally and through pests from every nature. And there's a new one on the market that we've just discovered, which I will share just very briefly. Now, have a look, because the theme I've chosen today is biosecurity. Why should we care? Okay? Now we talk about the need for every individual beekeeper to have an idea of what's going on, but they need to own the issues that surround beekeeping today. And I'll tell you, folks, that that is an encyclopedia of understanding. So it's a very hard process, long process for beekeepers to get their head around some of the unbelievable things that are going on in our beekeeping. So we need to be not just beekeepers. The thing today also is we've got to become bee managers. We have to take authority over what is going on inside our boxes, and we as beekeepers need to look inside our boxes. So many beekeepers have bees, but they never look inside the box. They just want to take the honey. So today, I want to start with slide number one, and that is a small hive bee. This is one of the things, this one was probably first introduced in Australia in about 1980s, and it is an absolutely amazing pest. It thrives in warm, humid climates. It comes from subterranean Africa, and I'm not sure how on earth it got into Australia, but some areas in the New South Wales coastline have been abandoned by beekeepers, very productive country, been abandoned by beekeepers because of these beetles. Proliferate unbelievably. These beetles can become 36,000 beetles in 6 weeks. Just insane. And they can really, really make a mess of your hive. Slide number three, if we just hang on there, is that we need to understand the cycle of the actual, this particular bug. All insects have cycles, life cycle. They go about their business and they lay their eggs inside the comb. And what happens is that they display multiple thousands of eggs, not just a few, but multiple thousands of eggs. And these eggs hatch out over, I'm not sure, the period of time, about 16 days or something like that. And the larvae become so numerous in the hive that they overwhelm the hive. And the bees abscond. They just don't stay behind. And beekeepers who do not look in the box will come one day to their hive, and this is what they will find. Not only this, because these guys, what they live on is the honey, they live on the brood, they live on the wax, and this is what will end up your frames will look like when you come one day, and there is the final product. They do not pupate in the hive. Grubs themselves, they crawl out of the hive, like the little creepy crawlies that they are, and they will drop onto the ground in front of your hive, and they will pupate in the ground below your hive. So one of the things that I'll probably speak about is prevention. So this is what we call a bottom board trap, where you put your hive on top of this board. It has a wide screen of 3 mil squares on it of stainless steel. The beetles will come into your hive and they will drop down into a tray full of oil or a tray full of diatomaceous earth or some other form of destructive material to give these in the bees. Do hassle. This is another picture of the same kind of trap. You can see the tray. It's not always easy for the people with bees on stands to have this kind of trap, because stands don't always stay flat and true. And if you're trying to put oil in there, it's very difficult to keep an even layer of oil in there without making too much of a mess. But there are all sorts of other different traps. One is goes between the frame, which you'll see in a second. It is also has a little oil reservoir underneath it, and the beetles are hassled by the bees as they do their work, and the beetles look for any dark place in the hive, and they will scurry along and they'll find this trap and they'll drop through the little opening and they'll drop into the oil, and hopefully you've got to come along a week later, or hopefully not, and empty it out and do it all again. Believe me, I have seen them full. I've seen them in so many beetles in a hive that it's just insane. But this is the story of our beekeeping, and so beekeepers today need to understand their game. Now this is just something personal, because this little guy here I consider my arch enemy number one. This little guy here, that everybody probably knows who he is, he's the rainbow bee eater. Now this guy here in spring, he's here in spring, and he comes along and he decimates my hive in the spring build-up. We say the spring build-up, that's when the queen is active, laying eggs in the hive so that the hive can become strong through the spring, so I can take the harvest in the summer. And this little guy comes along and decimates my hive. And I don't know what to do about him, and nobody can tell me what to do about him. Nobody is dealing with this issue, because beekeepers in the north, this guy's not a worry to any beekeeper below Rockhampton. This, you can see the guys, they are incredible flyers. You can see the insect up the top, this is in flight. And I've watched them incessantly, I've watched them kill my bees, and there's not just one, but sometimes 40 and sometimes 50 sitting in the trees, just decimating my apiary. So I have had such an enormous difficulty raising strong beehives in the last 3 years because of the overpopulation of these critters. This is another issue that we have in Australia, and one that the government has just given up on, basically. This is the Asian honeybee. This guy here was found in North Queensland in a yacht. He came into Cairns in Portsmouth, and he was in the mast. And ever since that day, we've been chasing this guy around the north. Now, there is a serious side to this guy, because this is one of the bees that harbour a very, very difficult and very nasty individual. They have always find a dark little place to live. I just recently killed one in a letterbox in my neighbour, about 3 doors up. Warned me that there was a beehive in the letterbox, so I went up and it was an Asian honeybee, and I managed to destroy it, and that was good. But these guys have got a very nasty cycle, because they are host to a very deadly insect. Here's the difference. If you see the two together, one on the side is Aspis mellifera, which is the ordinary European honeybee. The one on this side is the Asian honeybee. Now they are extremely small, but one of the most significant differences with these guys is, see how the wings on the Asian honeybee are square? You'll identify them by that. And that. So those guys are the host of these guys. And this is the number one arch enemy of the apiary industry in the world. This is the varroa destructor. They are a mite, a sucking insect, which actually fastens itself to the back or to the underside of the bee, and it just drains the bee of all its bodily fluids and kills the bee. You can see on this particular slide that there's a varroa mite on the back of that bee, and within two or three days, that bee will be dead. Now that's a very serious situation, because we have had varroa mite found now in Townsville. For the first time on June the 10th, 2016, varroa mite was found on the Asian honeybee population at Castle Hill in Townsville. But there is some good news, because the particular mite species was not a mite that readily transfers to the Aspis mellifera. Okay? So, as yet, we're still not completely lost. So, they're in the process now of trying to destroy those hives down in Townsville. But it's a very frightening situation, because this little guy's here have destroyed the American ape industry, and they have the potential to destroy ours. Why we have bees. This is what we need to save our bees. Because they are the number one pollinators of all our food crops in the world. So, if you're a beekeeper like me, it's like being a dog lover. How many people here have dogs? How many people love their dogs? Well, that's a bit like a beekeeper. Beekeepers love their bees, okay? So they care about bees, and so they produce so much good stuff for us, right? So they're worth the effort that we need to put in to save these little guys. Soaps, honey, creams, vinegars, all sorts of products are produced, waxes and stuff produced by the beekeeper. And so these little guys who are under threat, really in this time, day and age, need our help. And here she is, queen of the crop, and they are just amazing. This queen is just the science behind the queen and the knowledge that has been built into this queen has never ceased to fascinate me. How by pheromones she controls the whole of the hive just by the number of pheromone plants in the body. She just tells the hives exactly what to do. This is just a slide I put in because this is our Australian mating beehive. And look at that most incredible thing. This is the brood nest of our. This is not the one that lives in North Queensland. This is the little guy lives in below Rockhampton. But they are just amazing. This is a substitute. We may have to go fall back on these guys to do our pollination if our honeybee continues to be threatened in the way that it is. And this photo here, it's a bit hard to see that, but I put it in because it's the last photograph. It just goes to show the interaction between us as humans and what we have been to the bee, and what the bee has been to us. And here's this little guy, he's completely covered from his chest down in bees. So folks, the beekeeping industry is under threat. Sustainability-wise, we need to put a huge effort in to save our industry. And this is just a few things that are actually attacking our industry. There's many more, believe me. God bless. I hope you enjoyed that. Thank you.